friends, welcome. So in this today's session, we'll be discussing about the one term that comes in your topic, that is a taxonomy. Okay, so this taxonomy is a word taken from two Greek words, that is taxos and nomos. So taxos means classifying, nomos means with certain laws or norms, what we call it as. Okay, so taxonomy is one of the branch of biology which deals with the three words, that is, one is identification, second one is nomenclature, and third one is classification. So this is what taxonomy deals with: identifying the organism, describing the organism, naming the organism, and classifying the organisms to where it belongs to. Okay, these three terms will be going in detail. Okay, so taxonomy was the term which was first introduced by the scientist A.P.D. Kandoul. Okay, so he is the man who introduced the term taxonomy. A lot of work is done on taxonomy by one of the great scientists, that is Carolus Linnaeus. Okay, so Carolus Linnaeus, we call him as the father of taxonomy. Okay, and in India, it is H. Santapu who is called as the father of Indian taxonomy. Okay, Carolus Linnaeus, or you can even call him as the Carl Linnaeus. So Carl Linnaeus has published three books, that is Philosophia Botanica, okay, then he has published, that is Systema Naturae, and one of his famous book, that is Species Planted. So in this he has given the laws how to name the organisms, and he has classified plenty of plants and animals. So naming or classification of the plants you will find in Species Plantarum, and some animals he has named, identified and classified, that you will find in Systema Naturae. Naming of an organism is possible only when we describe that organism and we know that what organism the name is attached to, and this process we call it as identification. So for the identification, okay, description is most important of an organism. So whether it belongs to fishes, or whether it belongs to birds, or whether it belongs to mammals, and all those things. As the taxonomy became advanced, a new branch of taxonomy came into existence. So among that, one is systematics. So remember, systematics and taxonomy both are different terms. Okay, so classification, nomenclature, identification, describing the organism, that is taxonomy. Okay, so in a simple term, systematics is nothing but, so it is a branch of science which deals with the study of diversity of organism and relationship among those organism. Okay, that is what is systematics. Okay, and even in a simple term we can say that systematics is equal to taxonomy. Means in systematics we will be studying about the taxonomy, that is identification, nomenclature, classification and describing the organism, plus developing the relationship among those organisms. Okay, so this is what is systematics deals with. Okay, and this term systematics was given by the scientist, that is Carl Linnaeus. Okay, he is the man who gave this term, that is systematics. And later a new branch of systematics evolved, what we call it as biosystematics, or it is called as new systematics. So, new systematics term was given by Julian Huxley, and biosystematic term was given by Camp and Gill. Okay, so even this new systematics, we call it as the population
systematics.
New systematics, along with the studying the diversity of organisms, it deals with the phylogenetic relationship of an organism. Means, in a simple term, I can say new systematics is equal to systematics plus phylogeny. So phylogeny means, so evolutionary characters, how one organism is evolutionary related to another organism, how the organism might have evolved, like what Darwin says, man evolved from monkeys. Okay, so he could provide a lot of evolutionary relationship among the monkeys and man's. Okay, this is how the plants and animals, what we study in different phylums it might be, or different classes it might be, or different kingdoms it might be, it is because of the new systematics. In the studies of taxonomy, after identification, another most important thing that organism should have a proper name. Currently, we have nearly 1.7 to 1.8 million species that are been discovered or that had been named. Okay, so in that 1.25 million species are of animals that we know till now, and 0.5 million species are of plants. Okay, and many studies says that this is not the only animal species that are present in the world. There are more than 8 million species probably present. Okay, but what we know is just 1.7 to 1.8 million species. There are many species in plants and animals, or even microorganisms, or the entire living organism yet to be discovered. Okay, so such a huge amount of species are there. The names vary from language to language and countries to countries. Just if we talk about India only, just if I take one example, brinjal. So in English we call it as brinjal, or even it is called as eggplant also. Okay, if I talk in Hindi, it is called as baigan. In Kannada, it is called as barnekai. In Telugu, it is called as venkaya. Okay, like this, just in few languages only I am saying. So in each language, one particular species has different names, right? If I take another example of dog, okay, in Hindi we call it as kutta, in Marathi we call it as kutra, in Telugu kukka, kannadalli nai antu karithivi. So it creates a lot of confusion in identifying the animal. So what the scientist did, okay, they thought that there should be a single name throughout the world for a single species. Means, if I take the example, we humans throughout the world, okay, are one single species, that is Homo sapiens. All the mangoes, different varieties it might be, mangoes throughout the world with one name, that is Mangifera indica. So this method of naming an species throughout the world by a single name, so we call it as nomenclature. So this is one of the important step in taxonomy. After identification, this nomenclature was very important to avoid the confusion. So a method of naming the organism with a single name throughout the world, that each and every individual organism should have a single name all over the world. Okay, and this method we call it as nomenclature. So it was very essential just to avoid the confusions. So there were many nomenclatures that evolved, like polynomial nomenclature it might be, trinomial nomenclature it will. Okay, one of the most important what exists now, it is naming the organism with two words, that is binomial nomenclature. So the word only will say to you that binomial nomenclature means naming an organism with two names. Okay, and this system was proposed by again the scientist, that is Carl Linnaeus. Hence, this man is a most important person in the field of taxonomy. So, father of taxonomy. So, he is the man for proposing the binomial nomenclature or framing the rules for binomial nomenclature. But the first credits goes to the scientist, that is Caspar Boheme. Okay, so he is the man who proposed actually for the first time the naming the organism with two words, that is binomial nomenclature, but he couldn't continue that work further. But it was popularized by Carl Linnaeus, that is binomial nomenclature. So about this, he has described in his book, that is Species Plantarum dalli. So binomial nomenclature henge irbeku, adanna henge define madbeku, adu bagge ella en madidare kottide. Before that exist a polynomial nomenclature. So polynomial nomenclature henge ittandre, it was a huge words for one species, that was entire the description of a plant or a animal. So one plant bagge helbekandre buttercup ant on plant ide, adu the polynomial nomenclature henge ittandre, it was ranunculus, calcifabus, retroflexus, pediculis, falcatis, caule, erectofolis compositis antad hesri. Okay, meaning the buttercup with bent back sepals, curved flower stalks, erect stem and compound leaf. The entire description was there in that name, which I think if that existed, we couldn't have remembered a few names also. Okay, hence polynomial nomenclature slowly it was reduced and a new form existed, that is binomial nomenclature. So this made the human beings to easily remember the organisms, okay, by one common word. Many scientists frame certain rules how to frame the binomial nomenclature. So like this, in different books, so different plants, animals or microbes, how to name them, there is the rules for that one. Okay, in ICBM, okay, that is International Code for Botanical Nomenclature, so ICBN rules means it is a book which contains certain rules to name only the plants. So botany andre no study of plants. Okay, so plants na heng name madbeku adakke rules ella edralli sigutade ninge ICBN dal sigutade. Okay, so ICBN rules na again it was given by the Carl Linnaeus, which he described in his book Philosophica Botanica. So animals nomenclature, you will get that in ICZN, that is International Code for Zoological Nomenclature. Okay, in this there are certain rules how to name the animal species. Okay, so there are many other for your extra information, that is ICVN antanu ide, that is International Code for Virology Nomenclature. So in this you will find how to name the viruses, virology nomenclature. So again there is ICBACN, okay, International Code for Bacteriology Nomenclature. In this, you will get the rules how to name the bacteria. Okay, even we have ICNCP. It is International Code for Nomenclature of Cultivation Plants. So these are the extra things for you. So for your syllabus, you have these two terminologies, that is ICBN and ICZN. Okay. So what are these rules? Let us see. Let us discuss about the rules of binomial nomenclature. Okay. So first, let me tell the common rules for binomial nomenclature for both plants and animals. Okay. Let me take one example. So the example will be, that is mango. So, the scientific name or botanical name, if it is in animals, we call it as zoological name. So, common we can say it is the scientific name. Okay. So, the scientific name of mango or botanical name of mango is Mangifera indica. Okay. The first rule is that the scientific names should have two words. That is genus name or genus epithet, we call it as, or even generic epithet and sulpocal sitare, and species epithet. Okay, so if you are getting little bit problem with the word epithet, just you can write it as genus name and species name. First rule is that one, it should have two words. Okay. So that is genus name and species name. Always the first word we call it as the genus name and the second word we call it as the species name. Okay. The second rule says that genus name always should start with the capital letter and species name should start with the small letter. So many will write like this. So genus name should be written in capital letter and species name should be written in small letter. So if that is what you are writing, so it will become like this. So this is the not the way of writing. So what it should be? So the genus name should start with capital letter and species name should start with small letter. Okay, that is the second rule. Third rule says that so the genus name and species name, when handwritten, it should be underlined. Okay, when you write it, either in the books or board, anywhere you write the scientific names, either botanical or zoological names, it might be, you have to underline them. If you are typing, if it is in printed form, it should be in italics. Okay, that is the third rule. And the fourth rule says that the scientific name should be in Latin language. So why Latin language? Because so Latin is Latin. So because Latin language is the oldest language, one thing, and no one uses the Latin language. Okay. If no one is using the Latin language, then there will be no changes of words and the meanings for that terms. Okay. That is the main reason why the scientific names they choose to write in Latin language. Or if you want the name to be in local, then what you have to do, you have to Latinize those terms. Okay, one example I will tell you, that is a species named Rickettsia of the bryophyte, which was discovered in Mysore. Okay, so what they did, they gave that species the name at Rickettsia mysoriensis, means for Mysore, just Latinize that one by adding ensis. Okay. So we have many such examples. Okay. There are many species which are of local. Okay. So which are of our country. Like we have neem. Indicus indicate that it belongs to India. Originated in India. So one flower what you know, that is hibiscus. Daswada. Okay. The scientific if you know that. So it is Hibiscus rosa sinensis. Okay, sinensis, it indicates China. Okay, so it is the rose of China. Okay, like this, plenty of examples you will get where the terms are Latinized. Okay, that is the fourth one. So fifth rule is that, okay, so after writing the scientific name, okay, so the author name, the person who discovered that plant, who named that plant, his name should be written in abbreviated form, okay, short form. L indicates Linnaeus, or if I write, it is Lin like this, okay, it indicates Linnaeus, and this is the, and he is the person who discovered and named this plant, okay. So this is what we call it as author citation. Okay, so these are the five rules what they have described in your textbook. There is lot of rules which differ in ICBN, so naming the plants and naming the animals. Okay, one example I will take, that is rat. Okay, so rat scientific name is Rattus rattus. If you look at that one, both the genus name and species name are same. No botanical nomenclature you will see such words. Okay, no plants have both genus and species name same. Before they were present, okay, like Malus malus for apple. Okay, now they have changed to Pyrus malus. Okay, so genus name or species name same irade illa botanical nomenclature dali. Okay, are zoological nomenclature dali? Yes. Okay, so such names where genus name and species name are same, we call it as tautonyms. Okay, so there are many tautonyms. Okay, interesting thing to know about this one. Okay, Indian cobra, okay, it is Naja Naja. Gorilla, it is Gorilla Gorilla. Like this, you will get plenty of tautonyms in zoological nomenclature, but not a single name you will find in botanical nomenclature. After identification and nomenclature, it is important that these organisms are classified into the particular groups. Okay, so to understand all the living organisms and to make easy the understanding of the organisms, so we have to classify. Our next third step what we'll be studying is the classification. Organisms are grouped into convenient categories based on the observable characters. Okay, for example, if I give you some coins and notes and tell you to classify, so what you will do? So based on the number present on those coins or notes, you separate them, either 1 rupee coin, 2 rupee coin, 5 rupee coin, or 10 rupee coin, or notes like this, 5 rupees, 10 rupees, 50, 100, 500, like this you classify. Or based on the colors, you may classify those things. Okay, it depends. Okay, similarly, organisms based on their external characters, it might be, or internal characters, it might be physiology, it might be anatomical characters, it might be so cellular structure, it might be evolutionary characters. So many different branches of science, they are taken into account for the study, and they are grouped under certain categories, okay, or under certain ranks, or under certain steps, what we call it as taxon. Okay, so any taxonomic group, okay, we call it as taxon. What the scientists did, so they studied the different characters of an organism and tried to keep those organisms under certain categories. So what we'll be studying today as taxonomical hierarchy. So this taxonomical hierarchy was given by, again, Linnaeus. Okay, hence it is also called as Linnaean hierarchy. Okay, this is what we will be studying in your syllabus as the topic, that is taxonomic categories. Okay, so different taxons are different categories. So from the ascending order, they have been arranged. Okay, so what are those categories? Let us see them. Into the ascending order, I am telling. So first comes species. So after that you have genus. Next you have family, order, class. You have phylum. If it is in animals or in plants, instead of phylum use a term that is division. And we have kingdom. Okay, so remember this, what I have written here, it is ascending order. Of the organisms. So number of organisms keep on increasing, hence ascending order. So the arrow marks, if I show it like this, that indicates it is the descending order. Okay, and this is what we call it as categories or ranks, we call it. So any taxonomic rank or category, we call it as taxon. The term taxon was introduced by ICBN, International Code for Botanical Nomenclature. Okay, so some extra things for your competitive examination. So this species term was given by the scientist John Ray. Okay, he is the man who gave the term species. Okay, and the term class was given by the scientist Linnaeus. Okay, so phylum term was given by the scientist Cuvier, and division term was given by the scientist Eitler. Okay, so some terminologies which was given by some of these scientists. Okay, so now let us study one by one each taxon. So first one, or the lowest taxon or the category in the classification, we call it as species, and the highest category we call it as the kingdom. Okay, so species andre yen, all over the world all the humans belong to one common species, that is Homo sapiens. We are one species. Species, so it is a group of similar looking individuals which can interbreed among themselves to produce fertile offsprings. Important term. For example, if you take horse and donkey, if they interbreed among themselves, can they produce fertile offsprings? No. Okay, one such experiment was done where donkey was crossed with horse and obtained mule. So mule was produced. Okay, but mule was a sterile, remember. Okay, so hence donkey is a different species and horse is a different species. But all over the world, if humans interbreed among themselves, definitely they will produce the fertile offsprings. Okay, species. Okay, if you take mango, Mangifera indica. Okay, so if you talk about a lion, Panthera leo. If you talk about tiger, Panthera tigris. Okay, so if you talk about leopard, is a different species, Panthera pardus. All are different species. Okay, next comes the term is genus. So what is genus? Group of different species which are having a common character, common related character, we group them under genus. Okay, for example, if I talk about a lion, lion is Panthera leo. Okay, if I talk about a tiger, tiger is Panthera tigris. Both are different species, but they are having some common characters in that one, hence they are grouped under one genus, that is Panthera. Okay, if you talk about leopard also, it is Panthera pardus. Okay, so they are grouped under one genus, so commonly looking individuals. Okay, in plants, if I say potato, potato is Solanum tuberosum. So if I talk about brinjal, it is Solanum melangina. Another we have Solanum nigrum. Okay, so all are different species, but they have one common characters. Okay, but they are nearly related. Some characters, morphological characters, either it might be flower characters or leaf characters, are similar in them. Hence, they are kept under one common genus, that is Solanum. Okay, next let us come to the term. So, group of related genus which have some common characters in them come under family. For example, if I talk about lion, tiger, leopard, all are Panthera genus. Okay, so even that include another genus in that family, that is a cat. So cat is Felis domesticus. Okay, so Felis and Panthera, they come under one common family, that is Felidae. So hence commonly we call these animals as a cat family. Even if we talk about the plants, okay, so we saw about the Solanum tuberosum, potato, Solanum nigrum, Solanum melangina, brinjal. Okay, so even similar looking characters, even you will find in different genus like Datura fastosa, a different genus. We have Petunia, a different genus, but they have some related characters phylogenetically among them. Hence, they are kept under one common family, that is family Solanaceae, the literal. Okay, and if we come to the again higher categories, okay, so we discussed about the family Felidae, okay, and another family, there is family Canidae, which belongs to the dog family. So dog is Canis familiaris. Like this, we have wolf, so we have fox, okay, they all come under family Canidae. Okay, Canidae and Felidae, okay, cat family and dog family, they have a common character, that is both are carnivorous. Hence they are kept under one of the order called as Carnivora. Again, common related orders are kept under one higher category, what we call it as class. Okay, so Carnivora it might be, or where we belongs to, that is a primata, okay, monkeys and apes. Okay, so they come under one common class, class Mammalia. So this you have studied in your previous classes, that is class Mammalia, mammals. Okay, animals with the mammary glands, animals with the hairs on their body, right? Okay, and if I talk about the different classes in the animals, so we have class Mammalia, we have class apes, all the birds with feathers. Okay, class apes, we have reptiles. Okay, class Reptilia, we have amphibians, class Amphibia. So we have class fishes, Pisces. Okay, they all are having one common character, that they are having the vertebral column, hence kept under the phylum, right? Okay, and so vertebrates and invertebrates have a common character, what we call them as the animals, because they have locomotory and they are heterotrophic in nature. Okay, so that is what we call it as kingdom Animalia. Similarly, we have the kingdom Plantae, where all the plants are kept. Okay, like this, we have kingdom Monera, where all the microorganisms are kept. Okay, including in the kingdom Protista, we have kingdom Mycota, where all the fungi are kept. Okay, like what's the taxonomical hierarchy for you? Okay, your syllabus, you have the classification of humans, you have the classification of housefly, you have the classification of wheat, okay, and you have the classification of mango. Okay, okay friends, that was for today's session for you about the taxonomy and taxonomic categories. I hope this much is clear for you. Okay, thank you very much.